So sweet, there's no thrill that can compete with the thrill I feel whenever God's children meet. And on that great reunion day, when our Lord says, come away, and the saints from every land stream through the gate, joining wonderful people, what a sight just to see all the happy faces praising God in heavenly places. What a thrill that I feel when I get together with God.
Plenty of love, plenty of room in the fold, plenty of room in the family, room for the young and the old, plenty of happiness, plenty of love, plenty of room in the fold,
plenty of food on the table. No need to economize there. You know there's all you can hold and more besides, and the storehouse will never be bare.
Plenty of room in the family, room for the young and the old, plenty of happiness, plenty of love, plenty of room.
Well, if you're lonely and looking for friendship, and you're lost but you wanna be found, well, there's plenty of room in the family of God, and plenty of love to go round.
Plenty of room in the family, room for the young and the old, plenty of happiness, plenty of love,
Good morning and happy Sabbath to all of you. We are blessed in a very special way today. And we can say with King David, "This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it." Beautiful flowers here at Carlsbad Flower Field. This is a demonstration of God's creating power. He created these flowers and plants and animals and things of this earth to honor Him, to glorify God, to praise Him for His goodness and His love. Last Sabbath, we conducted a baby dedication, Janina Faith Pineda. Praise the Lord for her parents, Dexter and Ferlita Pineda. Now I have some announcements. I want to encourage our church family to please tune in during the Wednesday evening meeting. And of course, we have small groups during the week. Be part of that small group community that meets during the week. The leaders are sending you the Zoom number and the time. And hopefully, you will be part of our weekly meeting together. For others, it's bi-weekly as far as small group is concerned. Remember also that on Friday evening, Vespers time, we have a special program. And this is all about preparedness for the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, the outpouring of the Holy Spirit, the coming of the Lord Jesus. Be blessed. Friday evening, welcome the Sabbath by joining the church family through Zoom. Now, soon our church is going to be open. Please pray that when our church is open for in-person worship, that you will be part of that. Of course, we need to practice and we need to be aware of that health protocol that we need to follow. May the Lord bless you and me. May the Lord bless us. As we look forward to His coming, let's continue to share the love of Jesus to others through our care, through our ministry, through our love, through praying for them, and through visiting and even caring for those who are sick. The Lord bless you and me, and may we have a wonderful worship together this beautiful morning of the Holy Sabbath day. God bless.
Blessed are you, Lord, God of Israel, our Father, forever and ever. Yours, O Lord, is the greatness, the power and the glory, the victory and the majesty. For all that is in heaven and in earth is yours. Yours is the kingdom, O Lord, and you are exalted as head over all. Both riches and honor come from you, and you reign over all. In your hand is power and might. In your hand it is to make great and to give strength to all. Now, therefore, our God, we thank you and praise your glorious name. Amen.
Now glorified, King of all kings. Jesus, you're the sweetest name of all. Jesus, you always hear me when I call. Oh, Jesus, you pick me up each time I fall. You're the sweetest name of all.
Boys and girls, I'm so happy to be with you today to learn more about the Word of God, the Bible. This Sabbath day, I'll be sharing to you something that I use every time I go out. I bring this every time I go out in the sun to protect my eyes. Can anybody guess what that is? Sunglasses, or Filipino uses payong or umbrella. But here in the America, we use sunglasses most of the time. So I bring this everywhere I go, sunglasses, because I know this is very important, especially when you go out, because it protects your eyes from the UV rays of the sun, because the rays of the sun can be very damaging to our eyes. Now, there are other ways where I can think of how to protect our eyes, because what we see and what we hear sometimes affects a great deal on how we think and it affects our hearts and our minds. Now, do any of your parents tells you, hey, you cannot watch that one, you shouldn't be on that website, or you cannot watch that video? Your parents even sometimes have a special program to block certain sites in the internet, and I know it can be very frustrating, but they just don't do that out of a whim. Your parents do that because they want to protect your eyes from seeing those harmful things that could harm your mind and your heart. If you have your Bible with me, please let's open it and let's read it all together. We're going to be learning today about Philippians 4 verse 8. Kids, if you have your Bible with you, awesome. Now I will be reading in Philippians 4 verse 8. It says, "Finally, brothers, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, and whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent and praiseworthy, think about such thing." You see, I think this is our guide to be able to help us navigate or help us in all of the challenges that we face in regards with this protecting our eyes. Who wouldn't want to think of those things that was just said in the Bible, right? But you see, sometimes the world often turns away from all the things that are good and pure. I think that's just how the world is nowadays. That's the reason why Paul, he was the author of the Philippians, which we just read. The reason why he wrote this is that he asked us to think about these things that are right and lovely and admirable, is because if we think that way, we become that way. Isn't it true? If you want to be excellent and praiseworthy, now who wants to be excellent and praiseworthy? Raise your hand. Well done. Good. I hope all of you raised your hands. It's because if, you know, you have to avoid the things that will harm your minds and your hearts. And you can do this by protecting your eyes from the things that you shouldn't see. So use wisdom. Use the God word, God's word, the Bible. Kind of like you would use sunglasses to protect your eyes from the sun. And now if you're not sure of what movie to watch, or if you're not sure what book to read, or if you're not sure what site to go, you know, think about and remember about Philippians 4 verse 8. Ask, is this lovely? Is this admirable? Is this right? Think about those things. Don't go outside without wisdom to protect your mind and your heart. And remember that we could always find whatever we're looking for if we open our hearts, our minds, to the Word of God, the Bible. Thank you, boys and girls, for listening. I hope you will have a wonderful Sabbath day, and God bless you. I hope to see you soon. Bye.
The offering today is for local church budget. How can you maintain a church school? Your congregation is so small. This question came up from parents whose membership was at a nearby church that had no school of its own. We are so thankful to send our church here, but we don't see how you can manage. Our church can't afford a church school. The church was often struggled with finances, but by the end of the fiscal year, it had stayed within budget. The pastor and the church determined that educating the youth of the church was the top church priority. "It's our investment in our church's future," the pastor explained. "The children from our church school would grow to be church of the future. Not only that, but there would be eternal heavenly rewards for this church who had invested in the Christian education of its young people. So despite the challenges, this church channels 66% of their church budget to keep the church school in the black. They rejoiced to continue the sacrifice to keep their school. Their church school still operates today. The results are clear. Many of the youth from the school are still active members of the worldwide church. These youth give thanks for their spiritual care that teachers and faculty provided and to those members who contributed to the church budget year after year. The Bible is clear. Train up a child in the way he should go, and when he is old, he will not depart from it. Proverbs 22:6. Let us pray. Lord, we thank you for your faithfulness, dear God. We thank you that we can always trust in you. You are an abundant God, and out of your great mercy, you have given us so much. We give you this offering today. With it, we worship you and give you our whole selves. Please now take it and use it for your kingdom and your glory. Extend and multiply its reach and its influence, we pray. May it be a great blessing to many. We ask this in the powerful name of Jesus. Amen.
It is time for us to come to the Lord and give thanks. Say our praises and thanksgiving. For those of you who have burden in your hearts and also problems, and for those of you who are ill and at this point you are grieving, please come and join me and we will pray. Let us pray. Loving Father in heaven, dear God, thank you so much for once more you have given us this day, the Sabbath day, wherein we could worship you. Oh Lord, thank you for loving us as your children. May thy holy angels be with us as we worship you today. I pray, O Lord, that you will bless all the San Diego Fil-am Church members, the leaders, and our pastoral staff. Wilt thou keep us, O Lord, to unite and be with us as we go our lives from day to day. Thank you, God, for hearing and listening to our problems. Bless, O Lord, for those who are sick at this point. Will thou give them your healing power that they may be able to be restored to their health? I pray, O Lord, for those family that are grieving at this point. Give them comfort. And for those who are going through a difficult time, help them, God. Help us, O Lord, to be more faithful, that when thou shalt come in the clouds of glory, all our loved ones, our families, friends, will be ready to meet you in the clouds of glory. O Lord, thank you so much, and be with us today as we listen to your words. Bless us. In Jesus' precious name, amen.
Jesus, take my life and lead me on. Lord, you have my heart, and I will search for yours. Let me be to you a sacrifice.
Our scripture reading for today is found in Acts chapter 7, verses 30 to 33. And when 40 years were expired, there appeared to him in the wilderness of Mount Sinai an angel of the Lord in a flame of fire in a bush. When Moses saw it, he wondered at that sight. And as he drew near to behold it, the voice of the Lord came unto him, saying, I am the Lord of thy fathers, the God of Abraham, and the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. Then Moses trembled, and durst not behold. Then said the Lord to him, Put off thy shoes from thy feet, for the place where thou standest is holy ground. And may the Lord bless the reading of his word.
Hate crimes aren't new. It's not happening only in North America, but in European countries as well. The recent mass shooting incident in Atlanta, Georgia, on March 16 this year, that claimed the lives of 8 people, of which 6 were Asian women, only exposed on a highly visible manner the hate particularly targeting Asian Americans for a long time already. Even here in our conference territory, in particular, violent acts against Asian American, and Pacific Islander communities are no longer isolated, as noted in a statement released by our SECC officers on March 24, 2021. In California alone, 31 cases of hate crimes are filed every year from 2015 to 2019. An article from CAP Radio 3 weeks ago highlighted the efforts of California lawmakers pushing to expand hate crime laws in connection to the Atlanta shooting. This is a good gesture, I believe. Perhaps some of you may have firsthand experience of violence and hatred hurled at you, particularly for simply being an Asian, Asian American, or Pacific Islander. Some of us may not yet have been subjected to this horrific incident, and we do praise the Lord for that. But what are you going to do if this happens to you for the first time? Or again, for those who have experienced it already? Shall we keep silent and do nothing? What is the counsel of the scriptures in this type of situation? What biblical story can we consider as a model to admonish us what to do during a painful experience such as this? In Acts chapter 6, beginning at verse 8 and the whole of chapter 7, there are two incidents of violence I want to bring up, where in both instances, someone got killed. One incident was perpetrated by religious overzealousness or intolerance, and the other was politically and racially motivated. It was Stephen who died for his faith, while Moses, on the other hand, struck down an Egyptian for defending a fellow Hebrew being violently harassed. Who is Stephen? Stephen was one of the 7 deacons chosen to assist the 12 apostles in their ministry to advance the kingdom of God in their generation. Find that in Acts 6, 1-7. Stephen was accused of blasphemy by a group of former slaves freed by their owners. They were gathering at the synagogue of the freedmen and were not able to resist the wisdom and the spirit by which Stephen spoke, Acts 6:10. In his defense before the council in Jerusalem, led by the high priest, Stephen offered a historical perspective of his faith expression and conviction. In this customary Jewish apologetic, Stephen commented on the portion of the narrative that made Moses fail to lead Israel out of Egypt prior to his 40 years voluntary sabbatical leave or retraining. He claimed that Moses inaugurated his leadership role to free Israel from Egyptian bondage by killing an oppressor. Yet his kindred didn't rally behind him. He ended up fleeing to Midian instead, where he began to establish his own family. Stephen goes on to emphasize that this Moses, whom they, Israel, rejected, saying, "Who made you a ruler and a judge?" is the one God sent to be a ruler and a deliverer by the hand of the angel who appeared to him in the bush. He brought them out after he had shown wonders and signs in the land of Egypt, and in the Red Sea, and in the wilderness 40 years, Acts 7:35-36. On the other hand, Stephen stood for his conviction even at the point of death. He is remembered by the early Christian community as one who, as he was being stoned, said, "Lord Jesus, receive my spirit." Then he knelt down and cried out with a loud voice, "Lord, do not charge them with this sin." And when he had said this, he fell asleep. Should we then follow the martyrdom of Stephen or the vigilance of Moses? After spending some time musing about this particular passage, I realized that you and I need to commit entirely to God alone, not to someone or something, no matter how noble and sincere our intention may be. Yes, you and I need to commit entirely to God alone. But why? You may ask. Why do I need to commit entirely to God alone? There are two reasons I glean out of this particular biblical episode. First is pleasing someone else or committing to something else instead of God depreciates or reduces your purpose in life. Let me bring your attention to Acts 7:22-29, which reads, "And Moses was learned in all the wisdom of the Egyptians, and was mighty in words and deeds. Now when he was 40 years old, it came into his heart to visit his brethren, the children of Israel. And seeing one of them suffer wrong, he defended and avenged him who was oppressed and struck down the Egyptian. For he supposed that his brethren would have understood that God would deliver them by his hand, but they did not understand. And the next day he appeared to two of them as they were fighting and tried to reconcile them, saying, 'Men, you are brethren. Why do you wrong one another?' But he who did his neighbor wrong pushed him away, saying, 'Who made you a ruler and a judge over us? Do you want to kill me as you did the Egyptian yesterday?' Then at this saying, Moses fled and became a dweller in the land of Midian, where he had two sons." Notice the profile of Moses. Moses' qualification? Excellent. Going back to his privileged speech, Stephen, the first Christian martyr, recalled that Moses was well-pleasing to God, learned in all the wisdom of the Egyptians, and was mighty in words and deeds, Acts 7:20-22. With all the privileges of royalty, Moses received a magnificent education. He was trained as a statesman, a soldier, and an administrator. He was a polished, scholarly man who would have taken his place in any society. You know, educational preparation has a huge role, I am convinced, in attaining position of leadership and even the kind of job that may be available to you. It may be difficult to repudiate Ashley Friedman's contention about the importance of education in finding a job. And she said, almost without exception, a candidate's ability to get employed and to get the job they want comes down to the quality of their education and the degree of preparedness that they have for the role. Whether or not you know exactly what you want to be doing for your job, having a strong education and a strong background is the single most important thing you can do to increase your employment options and your earning potential. The educational and professional preparation of Moses as the deliverer of his people is irrefutably impeccable. Why did he fail to lead them to freedom? Let's see the intention of Moses, which I would say is noble. Let's look at Acts 7:25 again. And it reads, "For he supposed that his brethren would have understood that God would deliver them by his hand, but they did not understand." Moses understood his life's purpose. He knew he was providentially raised in Pharaoh's household and educated in the best university in the world. The responsibility on his shoulder is indeed enormous, but he was ready to assume God's assignment for his life, that is, to deliver the Israelites from Egyptian bondage. He was confident that God will bless his effort since he was the one who called him to this task. He did his part to stay on track and waited for an opportune moment. But did he wait on God's perfect timing? Let's now assess the strategy of Moses. Moses' method obviously is defective. Let's go back to Acts 7, 23 and 24. And it says, "Now when he was 40 years old, it came into his heart to visit his brethren, the children of Israel. And seeing one of them suffer wrong, he defended and avenged him who was oppressed and struck down the Egyptian." What do you think of Moses' timing to inaugurate his career? Is it wrong to defend the weak, the oppressed, and marginalized in our society? Shouldn't we stand against hate crimes? Can we blame Moses for striking that Egyptian down to defend his kin? What would you do if you were Moses in that situation? In his book, The Saving Life of Christ, pages 59 and 60, Major W. Ian Thomas made a perceptive analysis. He said, and I quote, "There was nothing evil. There was nothing implicitly sinful or wrong in the thoughts that filled Moses' mind. That natural feeling of resentment against a tyrannical people, mercilessly whipping one of his own defenseless brethren. But it was just at that stage that he allowed sincerity and genuine compassion to rob him of his true vocation." I don't get it. Sincerity and genuine compassion are not enough as motives to execute an apparently necessary solution to a time-sensitive matter. I mean, will you turn your back from an atrocity committed before your eyes? Will you do nothing? Let's go to Exodus 2, 11 and 12 to help us understand this sticky situation. And it reads, "Now it came to pass in those days, when Moses was grown, that he went out to his brethren and looked at their burdens. And he saw the Egyptian beating a Hebrew, one of his brethren. So he looked that way and that way, and when he saw no one, he killed the Egyptian and hid him in the sand." Did Moses have to kill that Egyptian really? Or was he acting on his own to make a statement in the presence of a would-be credible witness? Was there no alternative to avert that crime? Major Thomas sensed, and I quote, that the enormity of the need knocked Moses off balance. And in a false sense of dedication, he committed himself to the task instead of to God. In his sensitivity to the presence of man, Moses became strangely insensitive to the presence of God. How easy it is for us to do just that and relate our actions to the approval of or disapproval of men. Are you man conscious or God conscious? It is hard really to go against a crowd or your peers, your class, much more the entire school, your family or co-workers or the society in general. It appears that every day we are confronted with an inevitable task of seeking the approval of people around us. To be different is weird, kind of. It is much easier to just follow the crowd, only it isn't safe. Also, to commit yourself to a task, no matter how urgent and noble and humanitarian it is, instead of committing to God, sends us off track. In the words of Major Thomas, you are not called upon to commit yourself to a need or to a task or to a field. You are called to commit yourself to God. It is He who takes care of the consequences and commits you where He wants you. The Apostle Paul understood this priority when he reminded the Corinthian believers in 1 Corinthians 12:18. But now God has set the members, each one of them, in the body just as he pleased. Sometimes being God conscious rather than man conscious leads to a lonely path in the face of public opinion. It takes divine courage to do it. Like when Nehemiah was building the wall in Jerusalem, or Peter taking the gospel to the house of a Gentile, or Wilberforce or Livingstone campaigning for the abolition of slavery, or you standing for what Jesus teaches about the Sabbath, tithe, or marriage, for instance. Like Peter and John, we should come to a point in our lives where we can confidently claim by the power and grace of the Almighty that we would rather obey God than man. The second reason why you need to commit to God alone is only God defines and sustains the purpose of life. In Acts 7:30-33, we find that when 40 years had passed, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a flame of fire in a bush in the wilderness of Mount Sinai. When Moses saw it, he marveled at the sight. And as he drew near to observe, the voice of the Lord came to him saying, I am the God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. And Moses trembled and dared not look. Then the Lord said to him, take your sandals off your feet, for the place where you stand is holy ground. God's purposes in your life cannot be thwarted by the enemy forever. When you realize you are not living under his protection, God will call you back. When that happens, you need to be ready to respond and be sensitive to the means God will use to respond to that call again. In the experience of Moses, God initiates the call through a burning bush. Acts 7:30 emphasizes this. It reads, and when 40 years had passed, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a flame of fire in a bush in the wilderness of Mount Sinai. Do you wonder why Moses found the burning bush attractive? I do. If you find a burning bush today, would you be attracted? Wildfires aren't strange to Californians. Being residents of this golden state for the last 19 years have exposed us to the yearly danger of wildfires. In fact, during our 3 separate trips last year, we have driven through areas ravaged by fire that made our concern very, very real. It was reported that by the end of year 2020, that's last year, nearly 10,000 fires had burned over 4.2 million acres. That's more than 4% of the state's roughly 100 million acres of land. These incidents make 2020 the largest wildfire season recorded in California's modern history. But this wasn't the kind of fire that caught the attention of Moses, as we know. I can imagine Moses' curiosity was aroused not because the bush was burning, but because it was not consumed by the fire. Normally, when a bush burns, it stays burning until the substance that can be burned is burnt. And that may not take a long time, of course. This particular burning bush did not even consume a leaf. If that is the case, the fire may have been coming from something else and not from the bush itself, Moses would have thought. It is important to notice that God didn't call for Moses immediately when Moses saw the burning bush. Actually, God waited for Moses' response. Let's look at Acts 7:31 to 32 one more time. It reads, when Moses saw it, he marveled at the sight. And as he drew near to observe, the voice of the Lord came to him saying, I am the God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. and Moses trembled and dared not look. Do you think God would have called for Moses if he ignored the burning bush? I don't think so. As you know, God never imposed his will on anybody. He is big in allowing you to exercise your will. Although God is not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance, God will never violate your freedom to choose, and in his loving ways will do anything to snatch us from destruction only when we voluntarily cooperate with him. You see, God only spoke with Moses after he drew near the burning bush. When God got Moses' attention, then he revealed his plan for him and his people, the Israelites. Likewise, you need to watch for a similar burning bush experience that God will use to attract you to him. It may be an insight while you are reading the Bible, or encouragement for a fellow believer, or a message that hit home for you. The thing is, you ought to tune in to God's channel to notice him. Once you are convicted of God's design for your life, he will confirm it and instruct you what to do. Let's see how God confirms the call of Moses. In Acts 7, 32 and 34, God said to Moses, "I am the God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob." And Moses trembled and dared not look. Then the Lord said to him, "Take your sandals off your feet, for the place where you stand is holy ground. I have surely seen the oppression of my people who are in Egypt. I have heard their groaning and have come down to deliver them. And now, come, I will send you to Egypt." We see in this divine confirmation that God reiterated his promise to patriarchs and prophets who were Moses' predecessors. God affirmed to Moses his covenant with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Essentially, God assured Moses that as he, God, fulfilled his promise to Moses' forefathers, God will likewise take care of him and the people God wants him to liberate. When God calls you to a particular task, you will certainly not be guessing if it is his will or not. He will confirm it with you as clear as the sunlight. You will find it a joy to do God's work and not drag yourself to do it. There is a paragraph that gripped me deeply, and it said, "A man whom God had specifically raised up for a particular task, but who on the basis of his own sincerity and on the basis of his own enthusiasm neutralized his usefulness because he committed himself to a need instead of to God. He tried to do God's work man's way, and he had to learn that it is not scholarship but relationship. Not just his ability, but his availability that qualifies a man for God." It may not appear easy and cool, but in the long run, committing entirely to God alone takes the heavy burden of proving ourselves and our abilities to others. Having our focus on God all the time is a process we need to practice on a daily basis, perhaps over our lifetime journey. Jesus explicitly pointed out that fruit bearing is not our personal or individual task. Our part is to keep remaining, abiding, and staying with Jesus in a constant, meaningful, and consistent relationship of spending time with him. Then the rest will flourish as an overflow of a life committed entirely to him. My wife Kim and I had a fairly good amount of travel in some beautiful tourist attractions in the Philippines. Here in the US, one of Kim's bucket lists is to visit all 50 states, and we are only 8 States short. We have been blessed to travel also in some European countries and Israel. It's a huge blessing that in all these trips, we have not encountered being bullied because of who we are, Asian Americans. Having said this, I am in no way diminishing what other Asian American, and Pacific Islander had experience pertaining to hate crime. I, for one, would like to call on all to stop the hate crime. I call on everyone, everywhere, using the statement of our conference officers, and I quote, "We continue to deepen our efforts to model what it means to be makers of peace through our actions, words, and care, and keep sharing the message that there is no place for hatred, anger, violence, or fear. May we lead with actions that provide safe environments for all people in our churches, schools, and communities as we exemplify our commitment to the call of Jesus, whom we follow. By this will all people know you are my disciples, that you love one another." Let us pray. Dear Jesus, we praise you for who you are and the sacrifice you made at the cross for our redemption. As a consequence of sin, many people succumb to their hate, which may result to violence. We pray for both victims and perpetrators, for they are all created in your image, that you, your love may triumph. And please, Lord Jesus, come soon so all these atrocities will come to an end. Please bless those who decided to worship with us today and those who will be viewing it at another opportune time. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Thank you, Pastor Lim, for the powerful message from the Lord we received today. My hope is that you experience a fire flame that renews your passion and ignites your fire in your soul. Rekindle the flames that may have died out so that the enemy may not be able to extinguish your fire in the Lord. As we continue to provide this worship service through media instead of worshiping in person, we hope you received a blessing. I would like to thank all of the participants and the media team for their hard work and dedication in providing a powerful worship experience. As you go about your week, may God's blessing and favor be upon you. May God be with you, and may you receive the grace to trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean on Him alone. Have a blessed Sabbath, and we hope to see you again next week.